Welcome to my world.
Two escargot, pate, frise, two green salads.
Okay, let me talk to you.
Lamb chop, steak frites. Shouldn't you be doing something? Two smoked filet and a pepper steak. Come on, make the dessert. Chocolate tart, please.
As a cook, tastes and smells are my memories. Now I'm in search of new ones. So I'm leaving New York City and hope to have a few epiphanies around the world. And I'm willing to go to some lengths to do that.
I'm looking for extremes of emotion and experience.
I'll try anything. I'll risk everything. I have nothing to lose. I was born in 1956. And you know, I realized standing right here that fear of this country or anticipation of what this country may or may not do at any given moment basically molded my whole life.
Russia. This is the birthplace of communism. I mean, that's what you think of when you think of Russia, right? You think of the Soviet Union. You think of spies and James Bond. Guys getting sent off to the gulag. It's just a weird being here. This was denied territory for most of my lifetime. It was unthinkable, you know, when I was a kid that I would ever be here. And now here I am. So, I don't know. What do you think of when you think of Russian cuisine? Well, you think of borscht, right? And you think of potatoes, and smoked fish, and smoked sturgeon, cabbage. And of course, there's the fish egg thing, right? I mean, even the bad guys in movies, yeah. Let's have a little vodka and caviar. Yeah, bad guys. I've always been spy crazy. I mean, all my fantasies as a kid were, you know, wandering around in St. Petersburg or Moscow, undercover, evading, you got it, sinister bad guys with Russian accents. But today, I'm not evading my Russian adversary. I'm rendezvousing with him. All right, I'm gonna meet my guy. Recognition signal. Rolled up Russian newspaper, right hand, partly torn. Fish is red.
Only on Wednesdays.
Samir.
Tony, you made it. Welcome to Wonderland. Welcome to St. Petersburg. Happy to be here. You got the car?
Sure. Let's walk. Samir takes me to our car where he introduces me to Alexei, our driver. Samir and his driver Alexei are going to show me around St. Petersburg, which is a town with a long and glorious tradition and some mighty good food out here. This guy makes me nervous. He doesn't say a single word. We're supposedly on our way to a traditional country-style restaurant with live Russian folk music. That is, if they don't take me out to the woods and drop me in a frozen lake somewhere. Okay, so no frozen lake. But this place looks like a hunting lodge in the middle of Siberia. We're about, from what I gather, about 30 miles outside of St. Petersburg.
Yeah.
Where are we?
This place is called Podvorya. Nice Russian cuisine restaurant.
Country-style.
Country-style. You're gonna like the place.
Cossack dancing?
Cossack dancing is part of the trip.
Back in the States, you can't just pick up the phone and dial Russian takeout. So most Americans know very little about Russian cuisine. Many parts of Russia have a hearty tradition of stick-to-your-ribs meat and potatoes fare, not unlike the American Midwest. Podvorya specializes in traditional country-style Russian cuisine. Here in the kitchen, they're busy making everything from potato pancakes to traditional Russian dumplings, to meat and fish dishes. With, of course, a little cabbage. All of these recipes evolved through the centuries based on what the Russian people could grow or find locally. Of course, in the olden days, your average Russian peasant would consider themselves lucky to have even one of these things during a typical meal. Our meal begins with a bombardment of zakuski, traditional Russian appetizers.
Beautiful.
Okay, I'm really getting into pickles in this country. I have to tell you, I'm really loving this. We have pickled plums.
Yep.
Pickled grapes.
Vinegar.
Pickled garlic. Pickled wild mushrooms, smoked sturgeon, pickled lamprey eel. Let's eat. A huge bottle of chilled vodka has come to our table. This being lunch, I'm a little hesitant to imbibe, but Samir manages to convince me it's part of the whole experience.
Nazdravya.
Better?
Tony, you made it, man, but this time try to enjoy it. It's not like you are, you know, going through the test like in a drug institution. You enjoy the whole thing.
What do you know about me? What does he mean by that drug institution crack?
Ha 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 ha. happy.
I'm getting there. Don't worry. My shot three, I'll be happy. I think this is going to be the start of a beautiful friendship. Now, I'm famously not very fond of salads. I make a lot of fun of vegetarians and salad. I've always been not very interested in them. But here, it's different. I really, really love this. Possibly because salad is all pickled and seems to go very, very well with alcohol.
You're right.
Our main courses finally arrive.
The reindeer?
This is definitely my first reindeer. I've been cruel to so many other animals on this trip that I figure let's kill off Donder and Blitzen and Rudolph too.
How does it smell?
It smells fantastic.
Good.
And if you're making reindeer at home, what they've done here is clearly marinate and slow braise. It's very tender. Little juniper, dill, a boiled potato in there. I think I saw a carrot floating around. It's quite good. Do I think I'm going to put this on my menu in New York? I don't know that we're ready for it yet. Maybe for Christmas. Just to horrify children. Yeah, maybe like a kid's menu for Christmas. And a little braised reindeer. You just hear the little squeals. But Dad, he didn't kill Donder or Blitzen. He didn't kill Rudolph, did he? Yes, Timmy, he did. So it's one less reindeer Santa's got to contend with next Christmas. My work here is done.
All right.
Samir and I decide to head back to St. Petersburg to sleep off our vodka lunch.
Oh, okay.
Tomorrow, he tells me, is going to be a big day. St. Petersburg. Here, two centuries of autocratic czarist rule ended after the revolution of 1917. This place, the Church of the Resurrection of Christ, was built on the very spot where Alexander II, one of the last czars, was blown up by a terrorist group.
I can't believe it all kind of happened here.
But since the downfall of communism, this place is the site of a very different kind of explosion.
Buy something. Yep. $2.
Here's for bottle.
Free enterprise.
Welcome to the St. Petersburg. I love you.
I decided a little support of the new economy was in order.
Big fluffy hat.
Time for a little souvenir shopping.
I think it's too small.
Oh, yeah. Something like this in black? It's all up top?
No.
Like this? So do I look fat in this hat?
Yeah.
Oh, the worm.
Oh, the knife. Give me this.
Okay, viewer, please.
Oh, yeah.
This is much more my style. Yes, I like this one. I'll take it. How much is this for?
This is just behind the shoulders. It's $10.
$10, I'll take it.
Yeah, here you go. You know, when I signed on to do this series, I demanded three things in my contract, okay? No nudity was not one of them, by the way. Let's see. It was no karaoke, no dancing, and no funny hats. Well, one down, two to go. Okay, breakfast in St. Petersburg.
Should be an exciting experience for us.
Now, you got to tell me the name of this place what it all means.
Interesting. It's called the Utoshina Blina. Word-for-word translation, the Blinzy Party at the mother-in-law's home. And according to Russian old tradition, during this week of Masinitsa, holidays dedicated to the farewell to winter, the mother-in-law should invite her son-in-law for homemade Blinzy Party.
Right.
Since not everyone has mother-in-law, some people would prefer to come over here as a public catering facility with a great name.
Mm. Mother-in-law would not be a good advertisement in the States, I have to tell you. You have a hard time getting people into a restaurant. Okay. Quick recipe. Make a tender pancake of primarily eggs, flour, and sugar. Roll it up with almost any filling you can think of. Then saute until golden brown. And you have a Russian blintzy.
Okay, the place is known for blintzy, so
yeah,
this is clearly
that's
what I'm eating.
Specialty, so we
start at the top.
Blintzy with meat, with fish, with liver, with vegetables, with different fruits, with curds, even with caviar.
Now, I'm thinking of something, it's morning, I'm thinking of something a little sweet. What would you recommend?
Little sweet probably should be with curd and the dry apricot.
Oh, that sounds good.
An interesting combination.
So like a yogurt and yogurt and dried apricot.
Yeah.
Sounds good to me. Wonderful. All right, where are we now?
Oh, that's your probably flavor department with the homemade jam, sour cream, or the condensed skimmed milk, which is very sweet, but I love it this way.
Well, that sounds thoroughly frightening to me, but I want to try it. Sounds good.
You know, a little of this
on this here.
Hey.
This is kind of like a short order joint in the States. The griddle, certainly familiar, the steam table here, we've seen that before. Certainly we've seen this a few times in the States. I have a sneaky suspicion. I hope we didn't invent this. This is good. Oh, really?
I hope the Russians invented this.
Go, you can take credit for that. Please, be my guest. Yeah. There's something very eye-happy about this experience.
I hope you'll enjoy the typical Russian breakfast in a public place.
Yeah, I think yesterday I already had two shots of vodka by this time of day.
All right.
That's great.
So,
flavored dried apricot. Yep. And condensed milk reduced. Yeah. Really good, sweet, but not too sweet.
Yeah. Not only is this a great hot breakfast, but it turns out Blintzy's are wonderful for a vodka hangover. But Samir advises me to keep it light on this occasion because he has an even bigger surprise in store. After breakfast, my guide Samir takes me on a sightseeing tour. I'm beginning to understand why there was a revolution.
Catherine the Great lived here. And the horse thing's not true, by the way.
We're talking 5-10 people lived in this house?
Well, maximum.
5 or 10 people. I get it. Catherine lives there. Probably all holed up in one corner watching the widescreen TV, bored out of her mind because she's got everything she wants. And over here, I guess we've got where the loyal retainers live, meaning probably the chef. And if I were alive in that time, Catherine would be calling me up 4 o'clock in the morning for their, you know, her favorite peanut butter and bacon sandwiches or egg white omelets. No oil. That's the problem with rich people. Special requests. Okay? I want the vegetables on a separate plate, sauce on the side. Could I have the sauce and the fish on the steak, please? And you can't say no, right? You know, Catherine the Great calls you up 4 o'clock in the morning and says, so, you know, I want that Kung Pao chicken. I guess you're making it. I'm pissed at her already. If my neighbor lived like this, I'd kill him, too. After being suspiciously secretive, Samir informs me that it's time for his big surprise. And her name is Ludmila. A friend of Amir's, she's planning a trip to the local market, followed by a home-cooked Russian meal.
We're gonna do a little shopping, and we have a specialist with us. Strategic shopping, coming up.
Kuznetsny Market is St. Petersburg's largest and best stock market. It is not typical for this economically challenged country.
This is all wrong. Isn't it supposed to be like bread lines and no food? Like, this looks better than Zabar.
It's teeming with fresh fruits, vegetables, meats, and of course, pickled everything. Like so many Russians, Ludmila lives within a tight budget. So a little advice to consumers.
They should listen to this crowd like a heat-seeking whistle, man.
She is not the kind of woman you want to mess with at a red tag sale.
Very finicky shopper here. Just very definite ideas about what she wants. I'm really curious to see. I think we're going for borscht here. I'm expecting cabbage and beets. Touchdown. There's definitely negotiations over price here. She doesn't get the price she wants, she moves on. Usually with a rude word. I wish I knew what she was saying. I think it's something along the lines of how your beets suck. These are. How much do you think you're going to charge me for that? Oh, yeah? Jumping a lake.
Beets in hand, Ludmila moves on to the butcher.
I'm amazed by countries where the meat at the market is like not refrigerated. I mean, it is really cold in here. It looks better. It's better, fresher stuff than the stuff you see in the meat counter in the supermarket, all shrink-wrapped and sitting at the health department approved temperatures. We get spoiled by refrigeration, you know? Let's just leave it kicking around for a few days. These guys don't have that luxury. Sell it today, period.
If Ludmila's market prowess is any indication of her cooking skills, this is going to be a treat. In her kitchen, Ludmila gets to work. Immediately. This is a woman possessed. She never stops.
And
apparently, she never stops talking either. If I could understand her, I'm sure she'd be telling me she's making classic Russian borscht. Borscht is a soup made primarily of beets. While borscht wouldn't be borscht without the beets, there's a tremendous amount of flexibility in various recipes. Ludmila's also contains meat, cabbage, potatoes, and onions. And of course, her own special blend of fresh garlic and spices. While that simmers for a while, Ludmila starts the main course, small traditional meat dumplings. She starts by grinding the meat, the old-fashioned way.
Oh, so all of this was hand-ground?
Yes!
This is no joke. This takes some serious muscle. If Ludmila ever got sent to Siberia, I think she could hold her own. Next, she makes the dough from flour, eggs, milk, salt, and oil.
It's a long, complicated process.
Dough is tough. I'm hopeless with making dough. It senses fear. Maybe communism isn't dead after all. When it's time to stuff the pelmeni, Ludmila puts meat to work. simply a matter of time. In Russia, the presence of a guest is considered an honor. It is the host who should thank the guest. And my new friend Ludmilla is about to thank me with a hearty bowl of her home-cooked borscht.
Tradition, the way the legend says, it should be as thick so that the spoon, if you stick it in
the juice. And сверху нужно...
We saw it all being bought, saw it all being made. Now it's... Mm-hmm. Hey, watch me eat it. Perfect happiness.
Yeah.
I'm feeling good, actually. I'm right in the groove here. It's a simple food that chefs crave. It's home cooking. And for me, I'm continually fascinated by bread and soup. It's like alchemy. You know, you're turning simple ingredients into something magical through sorcery. Now it was time for us workers to enjoy the fruits of our labor. Ludmilla dishes up the pelmeni. Fresh pelmeni. Pork, beef, ground with onion, garlic, homemade dough, boiled and served. Everybody seems to have a slightly different style of enjoying this. I'm going for the mustard, horseradish, and sour cream. And of course, top it. Fresh parsley and chopped dill. As always, someone busts out the bottle of vodka with dinner. I will be donating my liver to science upon my return to New York. This is the way to eat. Forget about restaurants. Homemade food. There's no substitute for it, and it would have been a terrible injustice to have come and gone without experiencing something this wonderful. Alexei, the driver, pours vodka and cranberry juice for a toast. What a bunch of wonderful characters. Alexei, who never says a word, Ludmilla, who never stops, and Zamir, who not only turned out to be a good guy after all, but has quite the gastronomic sense.
Good food, good company, a gracious host, a good cook, and good vodka.
Thank you.
I think I'm really going to miss this place. What the hell are we thinking with the Cold War anyway? Hey, I wonder if that reindeer place is still open.